Good evening. I'd like to welcome all of you to today's event organized under the Gender Secretariat at Brookings India. The Gender Secretariat is a platform for developing and discussing research that fuels impact on policy in India through government, markets, and regulators. At Brookings, gender has always been at the core of the work we do. Our research from 2014 by Shamika, Ravi, and Mudit Kapoor was the first comprehensive study to document the growing power of female voters across India, something we see as a silent revolution. We have worked extensively with the data from the Election Commission of India to explain why there are so few women in politics in India. Gender is very much a part of our work on health and education. For instance, over the last 5 years, our research shows the extent of missing female patients in tertiary care, that is public hospitals. We have also explored the impact of pollution on maternal health. In the field of education, we are examining the aspirations of teenage girls and the impact it has on real outcomes of health, education, and labor force participation. Considering financial inclusion and empowerment, we have studied how financial inclusion of women has profound effects for society as a whole. Presently, our team is studying property rights and the impact it has on gender inequality in a society. Taking this forward, today's event is on Waiting for an Equal World, Gender in the Northeast, a book by Padma Shri Patricia Mukhim. Without further ado, I now invite Dr. Shamika Ravi to begin the discussion.
Good evening. I'm Shamika Ravi. Welcome to Brookings India. It's so nice to have all of you here. I must confess, while we say that gender is at the heart of most of our research, I must tell you that as mainstream economists, we do plead guilty to the fact that gender, while it is a part of almost every study that we do, it really is yet to become the kind of research emphasis and focus like health, education, infrastructure, and many other areas where we have had far more traction. Some of it has to do with also the demand for research in terms of, you know, how we are able to work with policymakers and the kind of data available and what amount of research we are. Most of us do analytical work. And what compounds this problem is particularly in the Northeast. You know, whenever we do research on the Northeast, most of the time we have to club it together. And it is not because we like to do it or we don't care about the Northeast, but the reality of research in India is that most of it focuses on the big 16 states or the big 20 states. Now, while it means it's 85% of the population, so from representation and the validity for the country, it's a good sample to look at. But the Northeast, because of the small samples, whether it is the NSS, the NFHS, all the large public data sets, tend to have clubbing, and that's not good. That means there is almost like a black hole when we think of disaggregation of information, when we talk about district level estimates, whether it is infant mortality, maternal mortality, and some other indicators, and I'll talk about them later. But today it gives me great pleasure to welcome a dear friend and a mentor, Patricia Mukhim. Pat has been a great influence on many of us young economists who have been studying India and Northeast in particular, that is of interest. Because Pat brings in a fundamental, she fills a gap in our understanding, which is of institutions. Whether it is the political institutions which are failing us, whether they are the social institutions, the cultural institutions, and her book, which I recommend highly to all of you, really provides us with the motivation. It is not a research paper, as she has very bluntly put it in the introduction. Somebody will problematize, I like that word, and come up with solutions for the problems, but these are stories. And a lot of our analytical work miss out on those stories because eventually the motivations come from exactly there. So I recommend the book highly to you. We are happy to have you, Pat. Tell us about what motivated you to write the book and what is the broad message that you want to give us to all of us who are interested in gender and Northeast in particular. Would you like to take the podium?
Thank you, Shamika, for that very, very kind introduction. Thank you all for being here this afternoon. Now, this book is a sort of a storybook of what one gathers as a journalist from day to day, from month to month, from year to year. But essentially, this book tries to dispel the myth about matriliny and matrilineal societies. There's nothing romantic about them, and there's nothing that's, you know, women in a matrilineal society are not necessarily better off and not naturally empowered, as people would like to believe. The book flags some of the pernicious issues and persistent problems that have dogged us for many decades. It analyzes the customary practices and the traditional institutions which do not have women as stakeholders. They in fact debar women from political participation in the grassroots institutions. And the book looks at the high level of teenage pregnancies which compel women to drop out of school. Meghalaya has teenage pregnancies of 53%, Mizoram 61%, and the highest, which is not in the Northeast, is Goa at 64%. So what happens to these women who drop out of school and then are landed with a child and very often are abandoned by the man who has impregnated them? They have to head these households on their own. And because we are a matrilineal society, the burden of childbearing, child rearing, and nurturing and everything falls on the woman. The infant mortality rate in Meghalaya is 39 out of every 1,000 live births. The maternal mortality is 241 out of 100,000 live births. And only 51% of women actually are able to deliver in any health facility. The rest are all in, you know, in homes. And in recent times, we've found through our newspaper survey that there are so many women who give birth on ambulances. Before they reach the health center, they deliver. Sometimes they make it, sometimes they don't make it. About 2/5 of the child population under the age of 5 are stunted, which is about 44% of them. There are children between the age of 6 months and 5 years who are anemic. 52% of women in matrilineal Meghalaya are also anemic. There's physical and sexual violence, which is on the rise. If you scan through the newspapers, you will see every month, there was a time when almost every fortnight you would read stories about a child being raped and minors being raped. And the rapist, one of them is or was a legislator. There are about 400 rape cases against minors which are pending before the POCSO court. So we don't seem to be getting anywhere in terms of women's empowerment, as we much like to flaunt. The access to credit for women is very, very low because we don't have these microcrediting agencies. In fact, I think Assam has floated one and it hasn't yet picked up. But Assam is a huge state. Before all these things come to Meghalaya, it will take a long time. Till date, out of a population of 4.6 crores in the Northeast, only about 22 lakh people have had access to microcredit, and that's mostly in Assam. When we come to political participation, look at all the 7 states. Nagaland doesn't have a legislator in this assembly. Meghalaya has 3 out of 60 women. Out of 60 legislators, 3 are women. Assam has 8. Arunachal Pradesh has three, Tripura also has three, Mizoram has none, Manipur has one. In Meghalaya, we have this construct where people say, if you engage with politics, you are like the hen that crows. So when the hen starts crowing, then it's very dangerous for society. You know, doomsday is at bay. But when it comes to voting, women outvote men all the time. Women are used as political agents, as, you know, going around canvassing for men. All of the male candidates will make sure they have a group of women going with them from door to door. So women are used but are not found fit to contest elections. Then there is the concerns of landlessness. My book speaks about this extensively, and I've asked that government should have the courage to conduct a cadastral survey, because we speak about a tribal community. We speak about being egalitarian. We speak about equitable sharing of resources, but that's not happening. Mr. Rao is here. He's from he's from the Assam Meghalaya cadre. The socio-economic caste census of 2011 says 76% of rural Meghalaya is landless. Now, if land, as is believed in the matrilineal society, is owned by women, then it means that landlessness amongst women is also growing. There is a very high rate of abandonment and divorce. There is as yet no study on that. This has led to very high numbers of female-headed households. And when I talk of female-headed households here, I'm not saying that because Meghalaya is matrilineal society, therefore the homes are naturally headed by women, and if the men head them, then that is a very different story. No, it's because women are forced to head these households. And the children of those households are not able to go to school. They become street children. And we have child labor also on the rise. Now we have tourism coming in a big way, but it's an unregulated sector. We don't have a policy on tourism in our state or in any of the seven states, not even in Assam. And we know that unregulated tourism impacts women adversely. We know what happens in Thailand and other places. We also have this privatization of common property resources. I keep telling people that we call ourselves a tribal community, but we are increasingly privatizing even water sources. We are privatizing forests. Wherever there are coal mines, there is a lot of land grabbing. Wherever there's limestone mines, land is being grabbed. And land is going from the poor tribal to the rich tribal. It's not as if somebody from outside is coming to exploit us. So when you look at privatization of water sources and private parties beginning to sell the water at a price, then we find that women have to go long distances to fetch water. That's a drudgery they would rather do without, but they can't help it. So this only exacerbates our problems. The conversation that we really need to have within these societies, including, you know, the other societies like Nagaland. Nagaland is very patriarchal. So in 2 years ago, when they wanted to have the elections to the urban local bodies, and women wanted 33% reservation to get into those bodies, there was so much of violence, there was so much of resistance from the male members of society. So the conversation we need to have is whether it is worth conserving a tradition, it is worth conserving the customary practices that marginalize women in politics and decision making. We really need to be looking at that, because we have, for a long time, propagated the wrong notions of tribal justice, tribal equity. We've propagated wrong notions about equal relationships between men and women. It's not like that. There is toxic masculinity even in a matrilineal society. And we now need to be focusing on the other players that, you know, that are influencers of society. For instance, we have the church. The church is such a powerful body. It's so, you know, it has a captive audience every Sunday. But what is the church doing vis-a-vis gender equity? It does nothing. It's a different story that all church leaders are male anyway. And in recent times, we've had a particular denomination of Christianity which prevented children from being vaccinated, which said that the Aadhaar card should not be taken because, you know, it's the 666. It comes from that 666 symbol of the devil. Children are not allowed to go to school. And, you know, so this happened in Meghalaya, but I'm sure it is happening in other of the so-called Christian states as well. So I think that the church now needs to take responsibility for this lack of development or all the malpractices that happen in society despite people believing in church edicts. Many of us who've attended gender seminars at every conceivable place, I think we've now reached a point of being psychologically burnt out. You know, we've heard too much and we've seen too little interventions. We don't know how to make those interventions. We don't know, we don't have institutions to interface with the state, with the government. The traditional institutions that we had and where we all thought we were there on an equal footing, they've now been appropriated by the state because you have what you call the MLA development funds, and all those funds are implemented through these traditional institutions. So they've become appropriated by the state and they've lost out on their social engagements. So in seminars, we do try to come up with suggestions, but we're not able to really see them through. And I don't think that we have also developed the societal resilience to pursue what we think is that good life that the tribal society started out with. And we are also aware that poverty victimizes women more than men. And if anybody cares to study the statistics in the Northeast, it will show you that there is declining progress of gender equality in the region as much as it is in the rest of the country. So all that talk about gender equity in the Northeast, I remember reading a piece by Ramchandra Guha, who had gone to Nagaland for 2 or 3 days. And then he came back and he wrote a piece in EPW, I think, saying that, you know, in Nagaland, women are so free to do what they want, to choose to do what they want to in their lives. I think it is very wrong if somebody comes for a day or two, or serves even for 2 years, and then begins to speak as if he or she knows the whole region, because every region is specific to itself. It has its own developmental concerns. It has its own strengths. So we have been telling people in the donor ministry, people in the Northeastern Council, please look at each state, and development has to be nuanced to the needs of those states. I've been given 30 minutes, but I think I'm done with flagging the issues in the book. So thank you very much for listening.
Public research at Jamia. So Simi, you have 7 minutes.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Shamika, for giving me the opportunity of being here. And of course, one has read Patricia's, Mukhim's writings all along, but to have a compilation and to get an opportunity to sit through and read and probably try to get a sense of how her writing itself has spanned. I mean, it's of course a lifelong engagement, but spanned, you know, changes and stood witness to the changes is something which has been really pleasurable for me, and of course also disturbing in so many ways, as she has also highlighted. To my mind, Patricia, of course, holds a speculum to Khasi matrilineal society, and I use the term speculum consciously. I don't say a mirror, but a speculum, as many of you would know, Lucira Garay's very important work, The Speculum of the Other Woman. It's a special mirror which allows us to see things which otherwise mirrors don't really hold to society. And I think there cannot be a better voice than Patricia herself to speak about the contradictions and, of course, the problems within the matrilineal society. There's of course no way that in which you can actually romanticize the matrilineal society in that sense. And of course she talks about how this romanticization is not really going to get us far, because I mean, of course, in her writing she spans the changes which has happened also in terms of inheritance. I mean, already we know within the structure of the matrilineal society there is the brother custodian, but other than that, I mean, with landlessness and of course inheritance itself leading to dwindling households in that sense, what happens really to the idea of clannish ownership, which was and of course now we see increasingly when in the kind of researches, and we've done some bit of research also on this in my sense, where we've seen that with this dwindling kind of ownership of clannish ownership within matrilineal societies, people who the institution of the khaddu or the institution of the youngest daughter inheriting the property is actually becoming now a social anathema. People actually prefer to marry into the non-inheriting daughter with salaried household, where you can have the possibility of having an independent household rather than getting into the structure of the khaddu itself. So which kind of tells us about the health or probably the bad health of the institution itself. But other than that, I think one of the most important things which Patricia's work also allows us to look at is that while we may have the matrilineal system or matrilocal movement with matrimony within the Khasi society, even if you look at traditional governance institutions like the Dorbar, and Dorbar itself, I mean, she's spoken about the traditional institutions themselves do not allow for women's representation, and so therefore it's not really surprising that in a secular mode of governance, whether from local bodies right to the legislative assembly, you'll only have 3 women in the Meghalaya state assembly in that sense. So of course there's a whole disconnect between what might be called the matrilineal, matrilocal, matrimonial space of the household and of course public institutions of governance in that sense. And for me, I thought that when I was looking at her work, what was very, very interesting, and since I come from literature and culture background, was that Patricia, on page 56 of her book, refers to a particular legend, which is a legend of Nokalikai, which is basically, I mean, if many of you who've been to Shillong would know, that there's a waterfall near Cherrapunji. And it's very interesting for me that in many of her writings, she also refers to a number of folk tales. And the reason why I'm posting the idea of folk tales is because we do read a lot of literature, culture, folk tales, folk forms, and folklores, and songs, and other kinds of instruments which come from the Northeast. But we don't really pay attention to the incipient kind of messages which are embedded there in terms of how gender itself is coded within these particular narratorial repertoires which comes from the Northeast. And for me, this particular narrative, of course, which she refers to in her chapter, where she talks about how this waterfall was formed, and just to tell you a little bit briefly about this particular narrative, there is this woman who was married, and of course she had a daughter, and then she gets married again for the second time, and she has another husband who obviously does not take very kindly, and so she has to go out and work, and he sits at home, and he's extremely troubled by the presence of this daughter, and ultimately one fine day he kills the daughter and cooks the daughter and feeds the daughter to the mother, and of course the mother ends up eating the daughter, and then one fine day when she realizes, when he confesses that this is what he had done, she actually jumps from the precipice and she dies. Now while we may talk about matriliny and one may talk about matrilineal system, if you look at, let's say, this particular domestic space, the woman is the one who leaps to her death. The daughter is the one who gets sacrificed, which then becomes some sort of a moral allegory for the kind of ways in which matrilineal systems themselves are structured. So of course, I mean, it's the girl child, it's the woman who finally gets sacrificed at the altar, even in an institution like matriliny in that sense. I'll just refer to a couple of more folk tales, primarily to be able to push home this particular point about how we must therefore look at these narratorial voices which also come from the Northeast. So this agonizing irony which Patricia Mukhim keeps on writing after writing, keeps on pointing to us, is very much part of a whole lot of Khasi folk tales and folklores and the narratorial repertoire which actually comes from the Khasi society. And I'll refer to another one, which is the which Patricia will know, I'm not very sure whether others will or not, but this is the legend of the lazy tortoise, Kapanchandi. And this particular folktale is basically about this very dirty, ugly, slovenly kind of a tortoise who lives in the pond, and there is this reflection of these male stars which actually find the reflection in this particular water, and whenever they kind of find their reflection there, she cavorts around the water, etc., etc., trying to entice. So the woman is then ensnaring one, the enchantress, etc. So one fine day there is a particular star who's called Lurma Khara, who falls in love with her. And even though there are remonstrations made by his friends that he must not fall for her and must not matrilocally move to the earth and to the pond and go and live with this into cohabitation with this woman, he does do so. And then of course when he does do so, he goes there and he discovers that she's ugly and she's lazy and she's slovenly and she's dirty, etc., etc. And it's very interesting what the since I have the tale here, I just read the last part of what the tale ends with. It's very interesting, the moral allegory which is kind of drawn about there for these lazy, ugly, dirty, slovenly women and it says, after these events, Kapanchandi's name became a mockery and a proverb in the land. Ballads were sung setting forth her fate as a warning to lazy and thriftless wives. To the present day, a forsaken wife who entertains hope of her husband's return is likened by the Khasis to Kapanchandi in a expectant attitude with her head lifted above her shell. Kapanchandi dem lo kha. So that is the kind of message which is given. So of course, while one may uphold matrilineal society, there are these embedded messages within the folk tales themselves which kind of code women in a particular kind of a way, which probably gives away the anxieties of the society itself. So it's not really a single kind of a narrative through which one can actually look at this. And then of course there are many other kinds of tales that I can refer to, but since I don't really have much time, but there is this very important tale about Kanyot and Kayam also, which also again codes women that if you're a timid and if you're an adventurous woman, then there is a certain kind of a fate that you will meet, and if you're a woman who's timid, then probably there would be certain kind of rewards that you will get. So there are these incipient messages which are very much embedded. Now the question of course which arises, is there any possibility of incipient resistance in these tales or not? And for me, I found this particular legend which Patricia will know about, which is the legend which caused the shadow on the moon, which primarily talks about how the sun and the moon were equally bright, but how did the shadow finally fall on the moon? And there is this whole story about how there's a household of deities, and there are these three daughters who are water, fire and sun, and then there's this moon who's the sun, and the moon, the sun becomes wavered, etc., etc. And there are and finally, I mean, there is this particular he starts moving in the nether worlds, and then he makes this particular incestuous kind of a demand for marrying his own sister, which is the sun, but the mother, dishonors him, etc. But the sun itself, that is the daughter itself, gets so angry that she actually picks up these hot ashes and throws on the face of the moon, and that's how the moon gets the shadows, and so therefore he never really can show his face at night, her face in the day, and has to come out at night, etc., etc., whereas the sun is the blemishless one. Now, the reason why I'm highlighting some of these stories is to basically say that if you look at many of the folk tales, the myths, the legends, the founding fictional kind of stories about, tortoises or about waterfalls or about rivers or about suns and moons, etc., etc., which essentially comprises the cosmology of the Khasi society, and of course it finds an echo in many of the narratives which actually come from here. you can see that the matrilineal code or mode, which is, you know, often held up as something which talks about gender justice in a certain way, can't really be romanticized in the way, because many of these tales actually give away a certain kind of an anxiety in that sense, which one can't really ignore. And these are folk tales, so it's not that these are recent stories or things like that. I mean, they have existed as part of the cultural repertoire of the Khasi society. And therefore, let me end with one thing that I want to talk about, which is and something which is really close to my own heart as well, which is that in chapter 13 of Patricia's book, where she looks at women's movement in the Northeast, she again, I mean, holds a speculum and primarily looks at that why women in the Northeast do not really come together and become a solid block, so to say, and why do they often, you know, talk in cross purposes. So of course, I mean, if you look at, let's say, the issue of AFSPA, if you look at the Mete women's group, or if you look at the Naga women's group in Manipur, they don't often come together on the same platform, even though their arguments may be the same against AFSPA or repealing of AFSPA, etc. And of course, in some ways, Patricia is very, very right in pointing out and flagging this particular issue, which is that that the reason why women are so divided sharply is primarily because of this issue of ethnicity itself, which kind of divides their own purposes to come together, because the ethnic divide is so strong. And so unless one sheds the baggage of this paternalistic imposition of ethnicity itself, probably women can't really build solidarity. So of course, one might have a problem with the term Northeast as a homogeneous category, which one must, but at the same point of time, if one has to move outside one's own ethnic boundaries and build some sort of a affinity politics or politics of solidarity, then that can happen only if one sacrifices some of the paternalistic baggage of this ethnicity, which is so paternal in itself. I mean, as Patricia very rightly points out. So to my mind, I mean, Patricia's book is such an important call, and as Shamika herself said, that I mean, we do seminars and conferences and discussion, but how far have we really moved? What is the efficacy ultimately of all this? Because we're still waiting for an equal world, as Patricia's title kind of says. And I hope that this particular lifelong engagement that Patricia, and of course she herself kind of stands for and has inspired so many of us, will egg some of us on to probably think of policy interventions through which we can actually make a real dent in that sense. Thank you.
Wonderful. Thank you, Simi. Thank you. Now may I invite Namita Bhandare for her intervention.
My very sincere apologies for walking in late. I never do this, I promise you. But blame it on my optimism. I did not anticipate the traffic. It's a long story. It's been a long day. Thank you very much, Patricia, for writing this book, which bridges two psychological distances. I'm referring to the distance in mainstream discourse of East, which I'm putting in quotes, and of gender. So in a sense, this book does cover a double gap in mainstream discourse. Thank you also, Shamika, and the Brookings Institution for arranging this discussion. Patricia Mukhim's book does not paint the picture of some idealistic Shangri-La, despite the fact that she's talking about a matrilineal society. It's a matrilineal society that is shrouded in patriarchy. And even though the family lineage is passed on through the mother's bloodline and maintained through the youngest daughter, there is clear evidence of patriarchy. The most glaring example is perhaps the most current example, the election results and the representation of women in politics, which even by our pathetic national standards is low. 8% of women in the state assembly and no women at all at the local darbar or traditional village institution level. In the most recently concluded parliamentary elections, Agatha Sangma of the National People's Party, who's the younger sister of Chief Minister Conrad Sangma and former Speaker Purno Sangma, won one of the two seats from Tura, so 50% representation in parliament, but let's keep in mind that there are two seats. What about other states located in the Northeast? What were the results? In Arunachal, there was one woman contestant, I'm not saying one woman who won, but one woman contestant. And she was standing against the sitting MP and BJP minister, Kiran Rijuju, who won with 63% of the vote share. Manipur, zero contestants for its, women contestants for its two seats. No woman has ever won in Mizoram, though this year one woman did contest because she had received a signal from God. In the 53 years since Nagaland has been a state, it has never elected a woman MLA and has had precisely one woman MP, the late Rano Mese Shazia, who made it to parliament back in 1977. Zero in Sikkim. Tripura, again like Meghalaya, 50%. Pratima Bhaumik of the BJP, actually she won with a wonderful margin of 3 lakh votes. So that's good. This thing. And in Assam, one out of its 14 seats went to the former Guwahati mayor, Queen Oja. Yet by another yardstick, if you look at women's participation in the political process, then in 4 states in the Northeast, Arunachal Pradesh, Manipur, Meghalaya, Mizoram, women voters outnumbered male voters in the recent general election. So something that's happening in the rest of India also, women are turning up in larger numbers to vote, they're not necessarily getting more tickets. One of the paradoxes of states that do well on gender indices is that they tend to elect fewer women to assemblies and parliament, as Shamika's own study has pointed out. So Kerala, for instance, has fewer women elected women representatives than, say, a state like Haryana or Punjab. But coming back to Meghalaya, let's look at other gender parameters besides electoral representation. That too leaves a lot to be desired. The National Family Health Survey finds that Meghalaya has amongst the highest incidences of domestic violence in India. As per NFHS 4 of 2015-16, total fertility rate of 3 is higher than the national average of 2.2. The use of family planning methods is also lower at 24.3% than the national average of 53.5%. And just over half of all births are institutional births compared to the national average of 78.9%. But on other parameters on gender, Meghalaya is to be emulated. Because the 3 major tribes, Khasi, Jaintia and Garo, follow the matrilineal system under which family lineage continues through the mother's bloodline, daughters are valued. And as Patricia points out in her book, this results in a social system where there is no dowry, where there is no pressure to get married. Marriage, when it does take place, happens with the consent of the woman. It's an informed, and despite the influence of the church, the growing influence of the church, cohabitation has not been generally frowned upon. The data reflects this status. Meghalaya has a positive sex ratio of 1,005, an above average female literacy rate of 82.8%. National average is just about 64, it's under 65%. The percentage of girls who marry before the age of 18 is just 16.9% compared to India's average of 26.8%. IMR, or infant mortality rate, is 30, again below 41. So, and of course, my favorite, female labor force participation, a subject of a great deal of consternation, or should be a subject of a great deal of consternation, is low at 35.9%, but significantly higher than 24.6%, which is the national average. Ladies and gentlemen, I don't know if you noticed a somewhat significant announcement made by Nirmala Sitharaman, incidentally our first full-time finance minister. The finance ministry is planning to extend and expand the Beti Bachao mission, and they're going to call it something, they're going to call it Badlav. Badlav is of course a lovely idea. The acronym, however, stands for Beti Aapki Dhan Lakshmi or Vijay Lakshmi. Okay, now some of us, myself included, are uncomfortable with equating daughters with Hindu goddesses, particularly in a secular country where minorities, Muslims, Christians, Sikhs, Buddhists, Jain make up 20% of the population. I'm also uncomfortable about the deification of women. You know, we are citizens. We have certain constitutional guarantees to equality and dignity. I would prefer it if governments stuck to the constitution, did not try and elevate us. We are not goddesses. I'm very happy being an equal citizen. Please don't deify me and place me on that stratosphere, particularly in a year when the Thomson Reuters Foundation has yet again, second year running, yeah, said India is the worst country in the world to be a woman. So leaving this complaint aside, okay, let's just come back to the idea of expanding the Beti Bachao scheme. As you know, Beti Bachao was launched in 2015 by Prime Minister Modi as one of his flagship schemes with the aim of bringing down female feticide. This is an urgent issue. There is no question. Whichever side of the political divide you are, everybody has to agree that this is worrying. The sex ratio is down to, what is the latest, 896, somebody suggested, yeah, but I think there's a little controversy about that. It is worrying, whether it is 896, whether it is in the early 900s, it is worrying. Now, what is this Badlav? Let's forget about the acronym. What is Badlav? It is basically a simple idea of the use of behavioral economics to bring about mindset change. And this is only to be welcomed, because we have been talking and talking and talking about mindset change since at least December 2012, if not before that, right? So we didn't do it in December. We know, let's just go back. What happened in December 2012? An awful crime led to massive protests, and the then UPA-led government set up a commission. Certain changes in the law were brought in, some recommended by the commission, others not. And we now have a very strict law and very strict definition of rape. But with the benefit of hindsight, right, let us consider what the public discourse actually achieved. We got a tougher law, and crime including rape and gang rape has not abated. We are hearing of worse stories, and we have not got any NCRB data since 2016. So I really can't tell you where we are at, because we have not been this data has not been released. But the larger message, if you look at it, what was the larger message that of the discourse? The larger message was public spaces are extremely dangerous for women. Rape is a heinous crime that is committed by strangers in buses, and women therefore are really better off home. Now, you know that this is fallacious. Everybody over here knows that the home is one of the most dangerous places for women. This is where domestic violence takes place. This is where marital rape takes place. And in fact, 95 or 96% of all rape that takes place takes place by men known, by perpetrators known to or husbands. Well, marital rape is not yet illegal, so it's perfectly legal to rape your wife, I presume. Yes. So. I feel that we need to re-examine this trope. We feel it kind of pushed us back into the house instead of bringing us out. So today we are apologetic about claiming public spaces, which includes the workplace. You know, so we've been pushed back. It kind of, when you talk to political parties about their plans for, you know, firstly, there's just one agenda. That one agenda is safety of women. And the solution to that problem is CCTV. So today the AAP government is going to put CCTV cameras into every classroom. I mean, it is, and the Supreme Court has chucked out a petition that questions it. Because of course children do not have any right to privacy or any rights at all in our country. So it's okay, you know, who's watching the CCTV? I worry about parents watching CCTV and then questioning daughters when they come home saying, why were you sitting next to that boy? Or why were you sharing tiffin from with XYZ? You know, this is what is going to happen. And it's actually seriously worrying that even the Supreme Court does not see fit and chucks out a petition. Anyway, I will leave all of that battle for Karuna. Let me come back to Badlav. Badlav also proposes to propagate role models from mythology. Gargi, Maitri, for instance. it wants to remind us that in mythology, children were sometimes referred to by their mother's identity. Yashoda Nandan for Krishna, for instance. Well, here we are in contemporary times. You have Meghalaya, where hell, children are taking on their mother's name. This is a living society, a contemporary practice. I feel we don't need to go back so far. We have an example in our own country. And I feel with all due respect and with all, I mean, I'm again saying I'm supportive of any badlav, except what the acronym stands for. And I feel that let's look at living examples and instances in our own country. We are not short of role models. We have a generation of highly aspirational girls. And in fact, it was here, I was sitting over there when Brookings had the presentation on TAG, Teenage Girls Aspiration. 70,000 girls in rural and urban India surveyed and by the Nundy Foundation, right? And saying 70% of them saying they want careers before marriage. This is girls in villages. This is girls in small towns. There is aspiration. These are girls that are upholding our living role models. Duti Chand from Odisha and Hima Das from Assam, who's just won her fourth gold medal in the last 15 days. So why should Meghalaya and indeed any of the states located in the northeast of India continue to suffer the tyranny of distance when in fact there is so much to learn and emulate? Ladies and gentlemen, let's go back again to the impact of December 2012, because that crime was so horrific and because violence against women, including increasingly in the northeast, remains so deeply embedded. It has subsumed all other dialogue. I am not saying that we should stop fighting the scourge of gender-based violence. I'm not saying that at all. But I am saying that we need to expand the limits of our gender dialogue to talk about other issues of empowerment, to talk about female workforce participation. Why is this dialogue absent in our mainstream discourse? I mean, apart from one or two I was commissioned by India Spend in 2014 to talk about it. It's not a story that any politician talks about. The politician will only talk about CCTV. The political parties do not. Or we will talk about representation of women in power. We need to expand. Empowerment means is a deep meaning, and I think we have an opportunity here. We have an opportunity. We have a woman finance minister. We have badlav. And I hope this will be an opportunity for us to put our heads together and work out a new blueprint for women. Thank you.
Fantastic. Thank you, Namita. Karuna?
Hello, everyone. I am delighted that we are all here and learning together about gender and policy making and, you know, maybe a little bit of law in Meghalaya. And I think it's really important in the heart of policymaking Delhi to be talking about this. So, Patricia, thank you for your book and congratulations. So this was very, very interesting for me, engaging with this issue, because of course, when we speak of a matrilineal society, it's true that everyone doesn't benefit from it, right? And it's also true that when we speak of membership of a group, particularly a group that policy, we being who? People at the center of power, people who are policy makers, people who are in government, people who are in law, right? The tendency is to think about it as a monolith. But we don't live our lives in monoliths. We don't live our lives with single identities. We don't live our lives as women from, women from Meghalaya don't live their lives as women from Meghalaya. They have individual experiences. So when we hear about the woman who was denied the vote in the CICOM Diengdo judgment, right? In the election of a Sardar, which is the local head. And because it is said that Khasi women traditionally and customarily are not meant to vote in these elections, right? Contrary to law. I mean, I can't tell you how contrary to law. It's really explicit. It says possibly because of the social cultural situation, the law very clearly says that the voter must be of any gender, right? Rather of all genders. And it uses the word gender, which is interesting to me. And as an aside, this is something that we've been fighting for a long time. For example, one of the things we wanted to do in the when we were looking at the passing of the 2013 anti-rape bills is make sure that the victim was gender neutral. So to say that the victim could be of any gender, because of course transgenders are raped at a massive rate. How do you deal with the rape of men? Do you deal with it under 377? It's a ridiculous law to deal with rape of any kind, right? But there was sort of a slip between the cabinet and our advice. So coming back to these women who didn't vote, and it was very interesting to hear counsel, look at the arguments of counsel. And these are sort of fairly senior lawyers in the High Court, right? In the Meghalaya High Court. Were you there for the hearing? Arguing that the women should not have voted, right? The women who did get to vote, that they should not have voted. Now, so, you know, it's when we talk about the gap between implementation of law, and we were talking about this earlier, right? When we talk about rights and lived rights and the implementation of law and law and rights as they exist, there is not only a gap between New Delhi and an individual Khasi, Jayantia or Garo woman, there is also a gap between the specific state applicable law and the customary law, even where it is progressive, and lived realities. So what does this mean? I mean, I'm going to say this about the state, but I also think this is true everywhere. It's true not just when you're talking about rights, it's true about any law, right? We have so many laws that the government has quite rightly started saying that these are old laws and they're going to be repealed, and so en masse, and it's been quite congratulated quite a lot for that. What about the others? Let's not go into the drafting process. It's not consultative enough. We have this ridiculous surrogacy bill without asking what the surrogates want. But in this situation, what I think a policy intervention, and I'm a great believer in making sure that there is a very, very important dialectic between policymakers and citizens, whether it's movements, whether it's people who don't participate in movements, whether it's frontline workers, frontline government workers, who actually know a lot if you ask them, or whether it's women who don't come out of the house. I mean, you know, Namita, what startles me actually, you're a sort of notable exception, is that I read so many stories, even by progressive women, and they don't report on, they don't cite women, they don't quote women. And when one asked, they said, but they didn't want to speak, you know. And then there was this excellent, I don't know if you saw, there was this excellent story by Pranoy Roy when he went on his election trip and he interviewed a young Dalit girl and who just happened to be standing there, and she only needed to be asked. She was incredibly articulate, and of course her life changed because people wanted to contribute to her education then. Anyway, so I think when we are talking about implementing laws, what we've got to do is have the various stakeholders sit down together. Now I'm breaking it down because this is a policy institution, right? Have various stakeholders sit together. Ministries, women's groups, again, frontline workers in from each line ministry, and say, look, this is my responsibility under this particular law to make this law work. Ideally, this should happen at the stage of the bill because it gets buy-in. And you can also then frame the bill according to what people are saying rather than just making it up out of, you know, saying, oh, this sounds good, right? Because I've read two papers on it and I sound articulate on it. So, the Ministry of Education may say that we have some out-of-school programs working with adolescent Khasi girls, and we need more trainers, we need perhaps a space, we need a bunch of spaces. So the Ministry of Education, can you give us some space? We need money, etc. Then you need a finance bill. You put it all together, so then you get synergies, and you then need a finance bill to make sure that the whole thing is funded. Now, it's not sexy. This is not exciting. This is not like the death penalty, right? It's not the kind of thing that you can speak of in rallies. It's the kind of thing that works. It's the kind of thing that makes sure that a law does not remain on paper. There are countries that by law are required to do this. In Brazil, this happens a lot, happens all the time. In South Africa, the Juvenile Justice Bill. I did a workshop for the UN with various South Asian countries on children's rights. And this is one thing that, you know, with governments of the various South Asian countries, and this is something that we broke down, and we had people who were doing this exact thing, Anne Skelton, for instance, to speak about their experience. I heard Simi speak about divisions, you know, in ethnicity, and I also think, for example, when we speak of women's rights anywhere, right, there are divisions based on politics. For example, when you speak of conservative women and progressive women in Delhi, you will have massive divisions, right? I think there is something good that has happened in the last few years, which is that at the more senior levels, at policymaking levels, there is an agreement around gender. I think there is a sort of across the board, there, which there isn't, for example, around free speech, right? But there is something of an agreement around gender. And this agreement is that, yes, you know, we must have, there are some issues that are headlined, and there are some issues that are left behind. I'm leading arguments to make marital rape criminal in this country, and in that the government has said that the institution of marriage must be protected, so there isn't agreement across the board on that. But making sure that there is less female feticide, making sure that there's more labor participation. The Delhi rate, by the way, is 11%. 11% of women in Delhi work, right? And it breaks my heart to hear the aspiration of the young girls who are going to succumb flat against the patriarchy as they grow. So making sure that hands are held across the board, fitness for purpose, looking at a specific issue and allying across various identities, various other intersectionalities, you know? And achieving goals is important because we cannot wait for an equal world, you know? There is a projection that was done in a study looking at if we just sort of trundled along the way we are in India right now, that it would take 400 years to achieve complete equality. There are also other studies that say that should you, women's movements and interventions speed this process up very significantly. So it is these interventions that I think are important. You know, I also, when I was looking at the fact that the youngest daughter inherits the property, but that she is also required not to work, therefore, she's also required not to go into, educate herself. This made me reflect on gender and the boxes that gender puts us in. And it's not just because it's not just women's rights, right? Because we sometimes celebrate the fact that women are getting the property. But what if her dream was to join the administrative services, you know? What if her dream was to, I don't know, be a singer? What if she didn't want to stay home and take care of her parents? What if she didn't want the property, you know? So it also makes us reflect on the boxes that men are put into. And so therefore, unboxing gender, I think, not getting it wrong, not thinking only of women when we are looking at a movement, and particularly when in policy interventions, I think is very important because the experience of decriminalization of 377, for instance, there seems to be a lot of barriers. There seem to be a lot of barriers in terms of accepting people of a variety of genders and a variety of sexualities. But I also know that there are a number of people who have important contributions to make. I think Mr. Iyer was Minister of the Northeast at one point, in charge of the Northeast. And I see many other people with important things to say, so let's take the rest into our discussion. Thank you.
Thank you, Karuna. Now, to take you all from absolutely the sublime to the ridiculous, which is what the job of the economist is, let me just run you through some of the statistics which my fellow panelists have already outlined. I'll just give us a minute. All right. Oops. Okay, so this is something we talked about, and we'll start with the very basic. Now, sex ratio is not usually a statistic that we talk about in many parts of the world, except in this part of the world, in China and South Korea. Sex ratio is a very strong indicator of what might be profoundly wrong with the society. Now, their part, Meghalaya actually looks much better than India as a whole, which doesn't mean very much because we do have states which have terrible sex ratio. And of course, the good thing is that Meghalaya is only improving its sex ratio over time, so that's wonderful. If you look at crime, and this is referring to Karuna and Namita's point earlier, obviously there was a spike. That spike isn't in terms of actual crime, but it's mostly reporting, which is a welcome break if you consider it from a policy perspective. We are able to measure things better. We are opening a system where there isn't a taboo attached to it, so that when you do have better measurements and better assessments, that's when you're likely to think of better solutions. There's something clearly happening in Assam. So the top graph is Northeast with Assam, and you can see that the Northeast without Assam actually looks a little better than all India. So obviously this is a controlled population as well. So if you look at per lakh, so there's clearly a lot more crime in Assam. If you look at now health and education metrics, now these are outcomes, which means these are important because India is a signatory to the SDGs, and the two metrics that we are following very closely are maternal mortality and child mortality. So we have had a huge amount of effort put over the last 15 years into reducing these two indicators, right? So in terms of maternal health, if you look at indicators of antenatal and postnatal care, for which we incentivize ASHA workers, for which we are actually putting a lot of facilities on the ground, Meghalaya PAD looks bad in antenatal and postnatal compared to all India. Okay. If you look at anemia, because it's one of the indicators of many things going wrong, it's also a very sharp predictor of the cognitive ability of the child born subsequently. If you look at non-pregnant and pregnant women, Meghalaya actually has much higher incidence of anemia. Remember, this is a matrilineal society. Underlying, it's important for you to realize that there are institutions there which do tend, at least the common belief is that it tends to favor women, and yet the outcomes of interest from a policy perspective that we see, there are clear problems, serious problems. If you look at infant mortality rate, much higher than all India. And India, we're still struggling. We've made tremendous strides over the last 15 years, but we still are some way from achieving the SDG goal. Meghalaya is much worse. If you look at schooling, what is the extent of schooling? And Meeta at the back is only going to look at this. Pat, the women in Meghalaya are actually at par with women across the country. It's the men we need to educate in Meghalaya. Okay, they have almost 3 years less education than an average Indian male, which is again not saying very much. So, and that gap between men and women at an all India level is not reflected within Meghalaya. Labor force participation. Now, there is something unique about Meghalaya. Labor force participation of men and women, but look at women in particular, is much higher, which means women are working. And I'll talk a little bit about the property rights and the ownership and so on. So economically, they're actually much more active than an average Indian woman when we think of policy, right? So there is much higher labor force participation, much higher, twice as high as the rest of the country. And that's fantastic. Twice as high, except maybe it's not an end in itself. That's precisely what I'm trying to drive at, that we have a very simplistic view in terms of economic empowerment when we say that women must work. Well, those women are working, except if you look at the overall outcomes like anemia and poverty and so on and so forth, maternal mortality,
they're much worse, right? If you look at property rights, you have a 0.43, so 43% women say they do not own any house, which is actually much lower than house ownership of women elsewhere in the country. So many more Meghalaya women own property in terms of houses, which is good. Sure. Okay, let's just get to the questions in a minute. Huh? In a minute, I'm sure.
It's wrong.
Acha. So then we must go and correct the NFHS 4 and hopefully the next round we can estimate it better. But this is a relative comparative statistics for data sets which are publicly available, and this is what we are using, right? Property rights in terms of land, so house ownership, women have more. In terms of land ownership, also bad. The women are actually reporting, fewer women are saying they don't have compared to the rest of the country. If you look at distribution of proprietary establishment, meaning registered firms, okay, MSMEs, firms that are registered, what fraction have women ownership? Well, 54%. All India, 22%. Now, of course, there are very few firms that are registered in the country, but all these measurement error is for the whole country. Huh? So in terms of standard metrics, Meghalaya economically is actually looking better, but of course, again, leading to outcomes of interest which are not much better, in fact, much worse than the rest of the country. So there's clearly something wrong. Financial inclusion is an important policy lever, and that is because we have enough empirical evidence within the development economic space, particularly for Bangladesh and its neighborhood, so South Asia, that financial inclusion has been a pathway to empowerment. And empowerment defined as many different metrics, whether women can travel, if you look at monthly per capita consumption expenditure, health seeking behavior, fertility rates. In fact, in Bangladesh, which is a conservative society by many metrics, the fertility rate has declined tremendously on account of women becoming economically active because of the microfinance movement that the country's had. And yet, if you look at how much have we in India used that lever of self-help groups, in the Northeast as a whole, very low as compared to all India. Now, all India, what drives the number are the southern states, because you have tremendous microfinance movement, again, mostly targeting women. And there is enough, again, statistics to show that when you empower the woman of the household, it is not just the economic activity, so monthly per capita consumption and other things, but education and health outcomes of the children improve. Now, naturally, there are barriers to growth. So these businesses haven't grown tremendously. There again, targeting men has proved to be better business opportunity. But the social indicators, the development indicators, the societal measures of welfare and improvement, making women economically empowerment through the self-help movement has actually been completely underutilized in the Northeast, and Meghalaya particularly so. There's almost nothing in terms of SHGs. Now, political participation, my articulate panelists have done a tremendous job of showcasing. Actually, that's not an error at the bottom. Nagaland, in fact, is zero. I cannot imagine in today's day and age, and yet, it is true, you have a state without a single female representative. In fact, the streets were burned, there was arson when the women demanded, in the urban local body, they demanded. Now, that goes back to Karuna's point of view, that well, there is law, and yet there is clearly a gap between what the law has empowered us with and the institutions on the ground, which are completely orthogonal to what we are aiming at. And yet, perhaps, well, this is it's a positive figure because we have a ministry. Now, of course, the solution to deep-rooted problems cannot be creation of ministries, and yet we have one in logistics. So as an economist, there are many other things to worry about. But donor is a concentrated ministry which has been empowered in terms of 10% of development funds going to the Northeast. That's not nothing. That's a lot of funds. We need now a systematic audit. And Namita, going back to your point of the economic survey and the need for gender auditing of our budgets. If the country is spending, we need to know how much of it is really going towards women's empowerment and women's well-being, because it is meant to be. And the finance ministry has been doing this exercise for some time, but we are yet to see the results. So I'll let that stay. Perhaps ask Pat, that Pat, do you see financial inclusion, the idea of well-defined property rights? Common property rights has always been a bit of a problem. It is not just of tribal areas in India, but particularly in societies which are natural resources rich, there is often an extractive government. And so we have enough, again, literature globally. Now, common property rights is romanticized generally, in the literature when people talk of, oh, everyone owns it and all is wonderful. The problem is, transactions become very difficult. Until you can, transact property or any form of asset, the real value of it cannot be realized. It remains trapped. What is worse is when common property rights gets captured, as Pat made very clear, by a certain local elite, then it's a very bad equilibrium. So we have to stop romanticizing common property rights. That's one thing. It also goes back to Karuna's point of individuals. We have to see women as individuals with rights. So well-defined property rights, perhaps well-defined even common property rights, Pat, could be, again, a policy lever that we talk of. So cadastral maps, a digitization of land records, all of that are likely to benefit women more because of the nature of the problem. Political representation, again, there are laws, and yet, Namita, there is enough evidence to support that, in places where women are empowered, the men cannot ignore them. So the political representation by the male candidates in states like Kerala, and of course by no measure are they, perfect societies, they all have their own problems, but at least when women are empowered, political representation by men means that they can't ignore the large women population. So issues of public goods, of what kind of preferences you have politically, do get represented. They are part of the day-to-day discourse. And yet in places where women are unempowered, and that measure of sex ratio is the simplest form of unempowered society, where you have 846 female for every 1,000 men, women are contesting elections, but they are not winning. Okay, so that's now a reality of life, the way we see it. What can we do? In fact, that thesis tells us that the costs are stacked against women. So the costs of entering public life is so high in those societies that women are just, choosing to stay. What can we do in terms of political representation, Pat? Anything in terms of financial inclusion and property rights? If we can have you just speak a little bit, in terms of positive way forward.
I think I buy that proposal for registration of land for a cadastral survey, because that will tell us who exactly owns how much land. We know that the tribal elite is buying up a lot of land in the rural areas and then alienating that in favor of different industries, especially coal mining and limestone mining. But you need the political courage to do that. This I have been saying for a long time, but because the political elite is also the owner of such land, it becomes a very difficult situation, and you will really have to be very, very bold. I don't know if we will ever have that kind of government, but that's the government that we need. In terms of political participation, I don't understand why this country has not pushed that 33% reservation for women, why it's stuck since kingdom comes, and I don't know when it was last pushed. So why aren't we working hard enough for that to happen? Because if that doesn't happen, we are never going to be able to fight with muscle and money and all kinds of, it is getting to be a very tough fight. In Arunachal Pradesh this time, we had Jarjum Ete, one of the leading women activists of this region, of this country. She couldn't even get a few thousand votes. So you can imagine how badly off we are placed when vis-a-vis men. And it seems to me that women again have become very compliant in terms of voting for men. I don't understand that psychology, but maybe we need to take a look at that as well.
So now we have 12 minutes, we open to the floor. Please identify yourself and keep your question limited to one, please. Yes.
Quick question, Karan Nagpal, a quick question on this, you know, reconciling this gap. You know, women are economically empowered, they own property, the male-female gap is much lower in Meghalaya than other states, you know, female force participation is high, and yet we, in NFHS 4 indicators, we don't see much movement. Is that because state capacity is very low? Because it seems like, you know, that those are the kind of inputs that, those are the kind of outputs that, you know, frontline health workers can help to change. So wondering about that, and secondly, just thinking about, you know, in terms of the solutions to these problems, right? Most of you have hinted at sort of a political policy solution, but how does, you know, given the fact that the society, the tribal society and the governing society is so biased against women, as you have explained, that, you know, are we optimistic about that? And if not that, what ground up movement can be leveraged to bring about this kind of change? Thank you.
Thank you. Hi, I'm Shalaka. So you all said a lot about how there are laws, but they're not implemented. And I'm wondering about all of these cases, which in other places would be corner cases, but in Northeast India, I think not as much, where the Indian state is not seen as a legitimate actor and their laws aren't either. And therefore, the laws which you do want to live by are skewed against you. So what do you think would be the solution in this case where the state is seen as an imposition or imperial, as some people say? Would it just be restructuring from within, or could there be like a hybrid system? Yeah. So we'll take three questions and then.
Yeah, actually, I'm a civil servant and I've worked in Meghalaya for quite some time. I know Patricia very well. One comment and another point for maybe discussion. One, about the health parameters that were shown there, I think it has nothing to do with matrilineal or patrilineal. It is something to do with a problem which is common to all hill states. They have infrastructure and communication problems. About, you know, particularly this property rights matter on which Kong Patricia also spoke. You see, when Meghalaya was created in 1972, it was consciously decided that we should retain the district councils. There is an anomaly in the sense that it is a tribal state which has a district council for protection of tribals. So, you know, the point here is who are they trying to protect the tribals against? There is a tribal state. Now, for instance, issues like cadastral survey, property rights, these could not be resolved precisely for this reason. Kong Patricia is well aware of it. So I think this is a point that requires a lot of discussion. And there are no easy solutions, but you know, many of the issues could be resolved if this dichotomy is solved.
Thank you. So, can we have the panelists respond, and then we'll go for the next round? Kongpan, do you want to?
What was that question again? Oh, it's difficult to remember.
Two questions. One yeah. on why should
okay.
And the second was on, does the low NHS 4 outcome numbers, does that reflect just limited state capacity in these hill states, as sir was saying, to deliver those services?
Yeah, I think the second question was answered by Mr. Rao, who said that we do have very serious communication problems, and many of the health centers are not accessible to many of the you know, the people living in very, very difficult areas, difficult villages. So that's one. And what's the other one he said?
Why should we be optimistic?
Oh, we should be optimistic. Yes, yes, yes. You know, we live on hope, yeah. That's very simple. We can't be pessimistic, because when you're pessimistic, you give up. So we continue to engage, but as I said earlier, our engagement with the state is very peripheral. A, because as somebody had said, we've always looked at India as a colonizing power, and we think we have these traditional institutions that automatically empower us, or are supposed to, but which have failed. So at least Meghalaya does not have that sense of alienation as much as the other states do. We do have a problem because we have two sets of legal systems, you know. For instance, the High Court of Guwahati at one point said that if a rape case is between a tribal man and a tribal woman, it should go to the district councils. The district councils are institutions under the Sixth Schedule Constitution. They should not have been there after the state was created and is being ruled, so to say, by the tribals themselves. But anyway, it has remained there because nobody has the courage of conviction to abolish them. But they don't have the infrastructure. No, we have serious problems here. Even when we look at civic management, the entire city of Shillong is divided into some areas called municipalities and some areas called non-municipalities, which are under the jurisdiction of the district councils. But the district councils do not have the wherewithal to address problems. No, they have neither the resources, nor the financial, nor human resources, nor the intellectual ambit to get into all that. So because, and then we have the third institution, which is the traditional institution. So all these institutions are at loggerheads with each other. In the end, the citizen suffers. And what was the other thing? Oh, that was about law. So I think Karuna can answer that.
The point that Shalaka and the gentleman made are sort of kind of related, right? Like you talked about the state as being perceived as external colonizing force. And you, sir, spoke about the district councils and preserving to some extent, yes? Booming lawyer's voice, can you hear me back? So preserving some of the traditional dispute resolution mechanisms. Now, the thing is that Patricia says that now they are essentially legally obsolete, you know, and even if you wanted to go, they wouldn't really work. You know, what we do, but I think it's also related, and I'd actually be interested in, Patricia, what you have to say, and I wish, you know, just a small note, that there had been more people from either Meghalaya or people who are sort of deeply familiar with the issue and, I, you know, for us to learn from. But I'd love to hear from you on, as you said at the back, what are the ground level movements and what are the impulses that can be leveraged and be in conversation with policy and with law, right? Because I think this is something that is really, really important, because top-down policy just isn't that great, you know? Sainath wrote in Everybody Loves a Good Row, he told a story, which is that, you know, when you think about roads, you don't think about the thakur that has to be paid off if you want to give it to the Dalit contractor, right? So you don't think about the security for the Dalit contractor. So many of these roads are not built. Anyway, he found a road in a particular district that had been built. So he went down this road. And at the end of the road was one village. And, no, I beg your pardon, one house. One house. So he said, he asked the people in that house, well, at least you have a road now, you know. Are you happy? And they said, no, we wanted a well. Right? So the thing is that unless you ask, you're always going to do the wrong thing. What we do when we have a case that comes to us, so we map what's working for the particular client, movement, organization, government, even, right? So you map power, you map what's effective, and then you see how the legal intervention fits and how the legal intervention can support the result that is aimed for. So I think a consultation with a really large and diverse swath of women, understanding what's working within the district council, right? What is your ability and desire to engage with the state?
you know, because this is what's available to you. There's a certain amount of power that you could leverage as an individual if you had, for example, a lawyer. If you had one lawyer, that's what you need, right? If it, like, people don't realize that, oh, it's the state, da da da. What you need? One decent lawyer. So I think that that kind of work is an intervention that sort of understands what's going on and has that very significant conversation. Starts, not starts, because obviously it's been going on for a while, whether it's effective or not. But it's an intervention that begins a sort of cyclical process that you want in any work.
Great. Perhaps we can take another round of questions.
I'd like to address the question of women's participation in political life. Our experience is contradictory. We haven't been able to push the 33% for parliament and the assemblies, but we have, by national consensus, almost everywhere in the country, increased the 33% to 40 or 50%. So why is it that politicians who are ready to increase representation for women, because women's participation is so successful, so reluctant about doing it at the higher echelons of our politics? In other words, the question that Patricia posed and the point that was being made by others need to be viewed together. I think the reason why the 33% has not succeeded in parliament is because you have to discriminate against men in order to discriminate in favor of women, unless you increase the size of the cake. There is no criteria on the basis of which you will disqualify men. It's not your saying that the one-third most idiotic men be removed, or the one-third of the most corrupt men be removed, or one-third of those who don't participate in proceedings be removed. You're just saying arbitrarily that one-third of the men will be removed in order to bring in one-third women who are probably going to be relatives of the men. So there doesn't seem to be at the grassroots level any kind of logic to this one-third proposal. And that is why MPs find one reason or the other to pass it where it doesn't matter to them. Nothing's going to change in the Rajya Sabha, and that's why it gets passed in the Rajya Sabha. But a lot is going to change in the Lok Sabha, and that's why it's stalled there. And the argument is never against the representation of women. It is this the right way of doing it? Ki par kati aayengi kya? This kind of a thing. But on the other hand, the very same politicians are enthusiastically pushing for the representation of women in the local bodies. Why is that? It's because right at the beginning of the system, we brought in Panchayati Raj along with reservations. So nobody needed to be discriminated against in order to bring them in. And then as we went along, people found that it was useful to have women, and therefore the agendas of the panchayats have been radically changing over the last 30 years. There have been spin-off effects that nobody considered at the start. For instance, we found in a survey that we did, it's now a rather old survey because it's a long time since I was the minister. But at that time, we found that even in the early stages of Panchayati Raj, the empowerment of women in public life, only to the extent of allowing them to contest, would empower them in the home. Now, this was nobody's intention, but this was a beneficial fallout. And we today have nearly 14 lakh women elected in our local bodies. There are more elected women in India alone than in the rest of the world put together. And it's an achievement that even women activists simply don't talk about, because the women who are being empowered are not Parkatis. So when your lot as a class, I'm not talking about you as individuals, talk about women's empowerment, you're talking about yourselves. And where the women's empowerment has actually taken place, there's very, very little attention paid to it. And of these 15 lakh women or 14 lakh women, about 1 lakh are actually running their institutions. And there are women panchayat members. I know a Dalit woman in Haryana, in Himachal, for instance, who has been president of her panchayat when it was reserved for women, when it was reserved for the Harijans, when it was not reserved. It's just that the whole community thinks she's the best. So therefore, in the Northeast, where Panchayati Raj doesn't apply, you don't get this result. You're getting it everywhere else in the country. And we made, I think, a big mistake, because I was involved with this legislation, in trying to be oversensitive to tribal customs and tribal usage. And so we said that the tribal women can just have their own privileges, and we're not going to interfere. So we didn't apply it there. So the problem that Patricia has brought up is a general problem, and my answer to it is that we should simply double the number of seats we have in Parliament, if necessary, abolish the Rajya Sabha. And for every constituency, if you had one man and one woman representative, automatically there'd be 50% presence of women in our Parliament. That's the only way I can overcome the fact that for so many years we didn't have women in Parliament, and we are now trying to bring them in. And as for tribal women in the Northeast, we should give them the benefits that the fifth schedule women have all obtained in tribal areas. The net result is that in a recent local body election in Karnataka, as against 33% reservations for ST women, the actual presence of elected ST women was 65%. So there is a way forward if you're willing to look upon it holistically.
Okay. Now, there are many things to disagree with what you said, but fundamentally I agree with you that this special treatment of tribal society has led to the kind of policy distortions which have perpetuated some of the problems. But again, just to make a pitch, there is a forthcoming study which is going to tell us what should be an optimum number of seats in the Lok Sabha. If we consider political representation as not being some, 50 lakh people being represented or 30 lakh by one MP is ridiculous, because there are limits to cognitive capability despite technology. So there is a study forthcoming in about a month. But Mani, there's also a lot of literature which has supported, what the Panchayat Raj giving the reservations to women have done. Not all of them have said that, the women have transformed the villages, and that's like defying or putting the women on the field. And expecting that when you have a woman sarpanch, things should completely turn around. But there is enough literature from the corporate finance area, because board membership is also, when we think of women's representation, we're always sucked into one part of it. There's another corporate India where you have 30% reservation mandated, and yet firms are finding it difficult. There is evidence to tell you that when they have more women on the boards, the firms are better run. The CEO compensation is more closely linked with the performance of the firm. So there are many good reasons and evidence to believe that good governance should be an end in itself. And to that effect, I think I will have to bring this, because we are 10 minutes past. We'll just have to take it over coffee.
Very quickly, I do want to address that, because then I have a voice of the former minister.
Okay.
There are many things I have to say, right? One is that I think we've got to remember. Look, I think your point that taking power is harder than increasing the size of the cake, I think you're absolutely right. But the reason that it was so easy to pass it, not so easy, because I know you worked very hard and it was a very valuable constitutional amendment, but the reason that it was powerful to bring this reservation in at the panchayat level and possible is because their own seats were not being taken away. Your own seats in parliament were not being taken away. Right? So it's always easy to empower others. When it comes to giving your own power away. And let's face it, all of us here are sitting on a heap of privilege that has been appropriated from Dalits, from people of different classes, and from people of less privilege. All of us here. Not just the men, also the women. Right? So I think one thing we've got to recognize is that when it comes to when sharing power and sharing resources and sharing privilege comes to our door, then the other becomes pargati. Then the other becomes, you all are privileged. Why do you need rights? Right? Let's remember that in Delhi, the women labor workforce participation rate is 11%. 11%. What you spoke of in panchayats and, you know, women becoming economically empowered and facing less violence at home. Marital rape in Delhi, extremely high. Female feticide in South Delhi, one of the highest in the country. So let's not pretend that all is well in this room. You know?
Hi, if I can take just 15 seconds of your time. Since we ended on women legislators, we have another event on 29th of July, which actually speaks about women legislators and how they affect health and economic development. So we hope to see you, all of you, even there.
Don't worry.